belle, c'est là que cet enfant a dormi sous son aile, a grandi sous ses yeux. Là que de ton haleine envers la passera, tu dis avec amour, et par où il la femme à cet âge de Dieu. C'est là, oui, c'est là.
Welcome back, and we're doing some Hints on Singing by Manuel Garcia. This is a little bit maybe less exciting if you've been watching on This Is Opera, maybe a little bit less controversial. But I think actually getting into the real texts, the real old school texts, if we're interested in old school singing, then probably we should be interested in going back to the source. So I'm doing this series where we actually just read the book. And so thanks again to This Is Opera for having me on. And we got this cool new feature now. Let me see if I can get this to work. Yes, and it works. So you can see we have Mr. Opera Chat and This Is Opera Chat. I forgot them labeled correctly. But it's like the Montagues and the Capulets, you know. So I know these are kind of like two different communities in a way. And it turned into like these are different camps. Like these are different sides of a debate, but the vast majority of This Is Opera fans and Mr. Opera fans that I've spoken to actually have the same, they have the same interests, they have the same, they want the same things, and they're into the same stuff. Often they're just really into the same stuff, so we can talk about that stuff, I think, whether it's Garcia or whatever. And I think, you know, the disputes that go on between the two camps, I think they seem to be driven by like a really small minority of people who are maybe not as interested in the singing as they are in the fighting. So let's see if we can do some. I mean, I think it's the fighting's really entertaining, but let's see if we can have Mr. Opera and This Is Opera reading Hints on Singing by Manuel Garcia together. And this is actually the fourth The fourth time, I'm hitting hints on singing. By the time it's done, we'll have read the first book. Well, at least the first part. The second part, I think, was a lot of vocal exercises. A lot of, it's not even exercises. It's just a lot of scales and stuff for you to sing. So, and it's, yeah, it's kind of boring. I mean, yeah, do them. Blah, blah. So, see here. Set this up. Okay. Yeah, so usually what's happened so far is people start filtering in when they will to the chat. So I'll check back once in a while to see if anyone's on the chat. But otherwise, I'm just going to keep... So back to here, and onwards, and let's see, I just got too much stuff on my screen, guys. This is hard, this live streaming thing. Okay, so here we go with hints on singing, and we'll need to hide this stuff. So where we were last time, we'd finished talking about essentially male and female voices and the different voice types as Manuel Garcia understood it. And we saw some interesting parallels with actually some of the stuff that was talked about on This Is Opera, and then some of the stuff that changed during the different This Is Opera eras, if you will. So at one point, they were talking about, like, chess participation. And then it, like, turned over, and they were talking about falsetto or something like that. And there's this interesting thing where Garcia, in this book, he's saying, I don't use the word falsetto anymore. But I was using it a lot. So it could be that the like whoever was doing those later TIO videos was actually looking at some old Garcia or something. So we've done the male voices, and here we were. Where we wound up was this section 8. We're gonna talk about timbre. And if you're coming over from This Is Opera, I mean, it's not the most popular series, so there's nobody in the chats yet. But you'll know I'm reading Garcia when I do my Garcia voice. And it's like, you know, it's like the words of Christ in red kind of thing. So you know I'm reading the book. And I'm doing my best to read and then comment later, not pass too many comments before we finish reading the book. Okay. What is meant by timbre? I'll turn this down a bit. What is meant by timbre? Answer. Every sound of the voice may assume an infinite variety of shades apart from intensity. Each of these is a timbre. What produces the variety of timbres? They are due, first, to permanent causes that affect the voice of each individual, such as the constitution, age, health, or disease of the vocal apparatus. Secondly, to the action of the glottis. Third, to the changes of form in the tube which the sounds traverse. question. Can you explain these changes? Answer. The path of the sound, being formed of elastic and movable parts, varies its dimensions and forms in endless ways, and every modification, even the slightest, has a corresponding and definite influence on the voice. Question. How is a student to select from among these intricacies of timbre? Answer. The timbres may be divided into two classes, the clear, bright, or open, and the dark, or closed. These two opposite qualities are obtained principally through the agency of the larynx and the soft palate. The movements of these two organs are always in a contrary direction. The larynx rises when the soft palate falls, and when the larynx falls, the soft palate rises. The high vault produces the dark timbres, the lower arch, the clear ones. The arch rises when we are in the act of yawning, and falls when we are in the act of swallowing. Figure 12. Vertical section from the front. Let's go back to these after we read a bit. And I'll check the jets here. Nothing going on. Okay. Question. What exercise will give command over the various timbres? Answer. This. In the same breath, on the same note, and on each of the vowels, a, e, o, the student must pass through every shade of the timbre, from the most open or bright to the most closed or dark. The sounds must be maintained with an equal degree of force. The following table shows what change each vowel undergoes in passing from clear to dark. The process must also be inverted. A approximates to O. E approximates to E in French. E approximates to U in French. O approximates to U in Italian. The Italian E and the French U in the head and high chest notes must be rounded rather more than in speaking, or their tint would be unpleasant. Carried to excess, these timbres would render the voice respectively hoarse and hollow, or harsh and trivial, like the quack of a duck. The student should thoroughly understand that the ring or dullness of sound is in effect and mechanism completely distinct from the open and closed timbres. The ringing and dullness are produced in the interior of the larynx, independently of the position, high or low, of this organ, while the open or closed qualities of the voice require the bodily movement of the larynx and of its antagonist, the soft palate. Hence, any timbre may be bright or dull. So let's go. I like this. Okay, we've done section 8. Let's cover the diagrams so we understand them real quickly. Figure 12 is a vertical section from the front to the back of the head, showing depression of the soft palate and high position of the larynx. Figure 13 is a diagram of the same parts showing the soft palate raised and the larynx depressed. Okay. So, I mean, that's pretty interesting. Of course, we don't think that anymore. No research has confirmed that every time the larynx goes up, the soft palate goes down, and that every time the larynx goes down, the soft palate goes up. That doesn't mean that's not what he saw, but remember, he's looking at people with these mirrors down the throat, and there's very little that they can do in terms of movement. Actual vocal tract shaping and movement, while he can still do that. And then the other way that he's coming up with these ideas is looking at cadavers, at dead people. And then he's trying to work out, you know, what would make different sounds. And he doesn't imagine perturbation theory, which is, that's what we can use today to get like a really intuitive understanding of how you get different vowel timbres, shall we say, with the vocal tract, without necessarily following these rules. And I think the reason he figures that the larynx goes up and the soft palate goes down to make things, how does he call it? He actually winds up calling this clear. So now he has clear versus dark. Before it was clear and ringing. This is really confusing now. His language before to describe the source. So the vocal folds themselves and the vibration that they're making. So he talks about a clear and ringing sound, but he's not talking about timbre at that point. So to him, that's not timbre. And when we were talking about this clear and ringing, I guess, I don't know what you call it if it's not timbre, but action from the glottis, so the source part of, I would call it the timbre, it's still the timbre. His notion of this is that you must have a smaller space to make these higher sounds, as he figures they are, these clear sounds. And then you must have a bigger space to make these darker sounds. And the way he talks about it is this arch. Let's see, where where was that? And then okay, and now he's making sure that so clear and ringing dullness of sound is in effect and mechanism completely distinct from the open and closed timbres. So I guess we shouldn't say clear for the sound. The sound is in Garcia's vocabulary. It's ringing or veiled. That's now it's confusing. So now he has dullness. So veiled and dullness would go together, I guess. And then clear and ringing. But now that's confusing, so he wants us to focus on ring and dullness. Okay. So it can be... So he's saying the sound can be something like... sound combined with timbre. So if we had like... sorry guys, I'm not... really great artist, but I'll put it over here. I think it'll be easier. Okay, so if this is clear and then this is dark, this line would be timbre, and then you would have something sort of like that, and then you would have ringing, and then, well, let's say veiled, because we don't want to use D again. So veiled and or dull. And then where you are on there would be, I guess, that your timbre combined with your sound. But I would just call that your timbre, and I would say that there's the source part of your timbre, and then there's the resonance. So, but for him, timbre is what you do with that source. And where was that language about the vault? Let's see. Oh, I see. I went too far. The larynx rises. Yeah. So the high vault produces the dark timbres. So high, to him, high soft palate, low larynx is going to make a dark timbre. And a high larynx and a low soft palate is going to make a bright timbre. And it looks like his low soft palate is actually, it's open. But I'm not sure. Yeah, it does look, so this is, it's not the best diagrams here. But what he means by soft palate is this part of the velum, the velum. And then if you, that's kind of, oh, I'll delete this. So you could say like the nasal passage opening is right there. And then he's saying that's the high soft palate over here on the right. And it's very, very little change on the diagram, but that's what he means. And he's saying something like, when your larynx is high, you're always nasal or something like that. So that's kind of interesting if he means that it's sealed or unsealed. If he just means that it's shaping, I guess, up and down, then you could conceivably have it not nasal and still raising and lowering the soft palate to some extent. I don't know that I don't think it's true at all that you have to do these things along with raising and lowering the larynx. And then of course with, if we can find his larynx on these diagrams. So I guess that's his larynx on these diagrams. And the one is higher and the one is lower, but it's very, looks like it's maybe very, very slight. But anyway, if that's the larynx, and you're working in the system that I use, that would be area number two. And then around here would be area number three, area number four, and area number five. And this would change, the locations of these would change depending on the where exactly is the end of the vocal tract is going to move where area number two is. Where exactly is the larynx is going to move where area number three is. And then area number four is always one third of the way, taking the shortest route possible between point number three and point number two. And number five is always going to be two thirds of the way from three to two. Depending on where those are, that's going to be a different place. So for instance, if you pull your lips back and you move area number two back, but you leave area number 3 where it was. Well, now the whole thing got shorter. And because the whole thing got shorter, where is 1/3 of the way? That moved backwards. And then where is 2/3 of the way? That moved backwards. So then where is the tongue relative to area number 4? It's like it moved forward. So when you pull your lips back, or you pull your jaw back, or you pull your neck back, or you do anything to make the vocal tract shorter by bringing area of number 2 towards area number 3, or area number 3 towards area number 2, you wind up redistributing these. And if you did that just with the lips, or otherwise the end of the mouth, it's like you moved the tongue forward without moving the tongue forward, in a sense. So, but when you push something into area number 4, which is most active exactly at 1/3 of the way, but and then tapers off in both directions from that. But when you constrict that, so constricting area number 4, that makes things darker. And if you instead retract the tongue towards area number 3, that's going to make everything brighter. So, and I think that's your tongue retraction, guys, that you want. And then if you do your tongue retraction and it's stuck somewhere between 3 and 4, like not close enough to 3, it starts to sound knurdly. Yeah. And that's the trick to sounding like a certain tenor that some of you don't like. Anyway, so that's more my stuff than Garcia's stuff, but it is what it is. So anyway, he's attributing these darkness and brightness changes to basically the overall size of this, and then the overall size of this. And he's saying, if you made this smaller, it's brighter, and if you make this bigger, it's darker. And I'm saying, no, that's not how that works. The reason maybe that option on the right got darker is perhaps that this area, number 3, wound up getting relaxed. Because when you loosen this area, you lower all of the resonant frequencies in the vocal tract. But at the same time, what could be making this one bright, and also this one is, sorry, on the, oh, let's go back to the right. And I'll erase this. So, if you look at the distance between area number 2 and then area number 3, you get something. So basically 3 minus 2 equals 1. So you get something called area of interest number 1. An area of interest number 1 is actually just how long is the shortest path from 3 to 2. So 3 minus 2 equals 1. It's easy to remember. So your overall length is area of interest number 1. Doesn't matter how much volume is in there. What matters is that measurement. The shortest path you could take from 3 to 2. From the larynx to the end of the vocal tract, which changes depending on the lips, jaw, teeth, etc. Neck is going to move that area back or forward. So when you shorten area of interest number 1, you raise all the resonances. So it's bright. So 1, it goes down and that the length goes down, and that raises all the resonances. And in this one, one goes up, and that lowers all the resonances. So it makes things dark. And then at the same time, if they were doing some other things to these other areas, they would still be affecting the timbre and what maybe what he calls vowels or vowel timbre. And if you have all five of them, they always go... The next one always reverses in terms of how it works compared to the previous. So number two, if you relax it, it sends everything down. I'll just take you back to the beginning. So number two, and we'll put number three here. Number two, if you make it bigger, that raises all the resonances of the whole thing, right? Number five over here, when you make it bigger, that lowers, but what it lowers is the second, what it lowers is the second resonance. And then number four, if you make it bigger, it raises. But what it raises is going to be the second resonance. And of course, these are affecting, there's other resonances getting affected when they run into these constrictions and expansions, I guess. But I focus on these first two resonances. And then number three, it's the opposite again. When you constrict it, resonances go up, and when you expand it, resonances go down. But it's all of the resonances, right? So that's what I think Garcia gets wrong, but I don't think he could have gotten it right without not only discovering all the things he discovered, but then also inventing perturbation theory all by himself. So figure 14. Let's look at figure 14. The space between the tongue and the palate as seen through the mouth during the production of the clear or bright timbre. So that goes with what I was saying before, that when you constrict area of interest number five, which would be two-thirds of the way to the end, that's going to raise resonances. And figure 14 is basically area of interest number five. And then the same goes for figure 15. That's also area of interest number five. When you make that bigger, the upper half of your vowel gets darker. And when you make it smaller, let's say the upper half of your vowel gets brighter. If you want to think about it that way. That's not scientific, but yeah. Now this part is basically this is your basic vowel modification that he's talking about here. This is the vowel modification he recommends for classical singing. And you can see it's all basically saying cover when you go up. So your is turning into it's going towards eventually. And then your is going eventually. And then your e is going eventually. And your eventually. And of course that's one way of doing things. But of course then we also see people doing things differently. You know, Italian tenors doing and not covering it when they go up. Not turning it into kind of and people singing E at the bottom, and then when they go up, they're maybe not turning it into or not doing it all the time. Maybe sometimes E is just turning into like eh, or even something close to eh. Or even if it's really high and nobody cares anymore, just just anything you can manage. But anyway, that's your vowel modification in Garcia's. Garcia's way of doing things, and it's useful. You're basically as you're going up, you're tuning your timbre down, relatively down. And some of that is required, because if you have your whole timbre too high, you might have the second resonance of the voice too high to match the third harmonic of the voice, and we like that sound in opera for our tenor, what people might call a head range, or I don't know, I don't really use these terms, but above the passaggio, maybe, I don't really use that either, but above F4, that area, we like to hear this specific relationship between the second resonance of the voice and the third harmonic of the pitch. But when we're below that, so like a baritone's entire life, basically, and then definitely a bass's entire life, with few exceptions, most of their singing is done without any requirement for any specific resonance to do anything. It's just not in the speech range. It's just not something that matters, how you tune your timbre. And you know, if any overtones are being reinforced, doesn't matter. And also in that range, because of math, what happens is a whole bunch of overtones become really close together as far as whether or not you'd be able to move your, say, your tongue just a little bit, or otherwise tune some resonance of the voice just a little bit so that it's on a harmonic and reinforcing that harmonic, it's really easy to do in the speech range. So I can do, without much movement, I can do these like, there's not much movement involved. Distance between where I would have to park the tongue to reinforce an overtone is not far. And as I sing higher and higher, it gets further and further. So it's not that people in the speech range are not often, shall we say, reinforcing a specific overtone. It's just that it's incidental, and sometimes it's hard, like, not to do it. And it doesn't, in that range, contribute to slowing down how much air is coming out and making it possible to push a little bit without the air escaping, thus making everything louder and raising subglottal pressure. But what resists the air when you hit a formant harmonic coupling, other than what it was already resisting the air, is a kind of new, I think, non-linear relationship between the sound in the vocal tract that is being reflected to the vocal folds and the vocal folds themselves, so that you're actually using the sound to assist the vocal folds, not in what is called glottal pulse skewing, but I think just in gluing the vocal folds together longer and making them take a bigger part of the, let's say, if you're looking at a graph in contact, and then that gives them actually less time to open and close again. So how far they're going to go when they open is going to be less. Anyway, so let's check the chat. See if we got any questions here. Nah. The Garcia's not as... not as popular. Because I guess, you know, we're reading books. It's not the most exciting. Let's get back to it. So, let's get on to section 9. I think we've explained section 8. Oh, he's also saying, before we finish section 8, he's kind of mentioning that source is independent to some extent. He doesn't call it independent, which is good. It's not independent, but it's distinct from the resonance, or what he calls timbre. I call the whole package put together timbre, but he calls the source your sound, and then your resonance your timbre. But he's saying that the mechanism and such and such of the source itself, the larynx, the vocal folds, is distinct from then what you do with the filter, with the vocal tract. And that's true. It's just not independent completely. So that part's hasn't panned out. 9. Preparation. Oh, jeez. That's embarrassing. Preparation for emitting the voice. Question. How do you prepare for emitting the voice? Answer. By giving attention to the position of the body, the separation of the jaws, the shape of the throat, and the breathing. Question. How would you describe the position of the body? Answer. The body must be straight. well planted on the feet and without any other support. The shoulders well back, the head erect, the expression of the face calm. Question. Should the mouth be opened wide as a means of obtaining power and beauty of sound? Answer. This is a common error. The mouth should be opened by the natural fall of the jaw. This movement, which separates the jaws by the thickness of a finger and leaves the lips alone, gives the mouth an easy and natural form. The tongue must be kept limp and motionless, neither raised at the point nor swollen at the root. Finally, the soft palate must be raised as in taking a full breath. The exaggerated opening favors neither low nor high notes. In the latter case, it may help the vocalist to scream, but that is not singing. The face loses charm, and the voice assumes a violent and vulgar tone. The real mouth of a singer ought to be considered the pharynx. Why so? Because it is in the pharynx that is found the causation of timbres. The facial mouth is but a door through which the voice passes. Still, if this door were not sufficiently open, sounds could not issue freely. How can you regulate the opening of the mouth? Answer. Those who find it difficult either to diminish or increase the opening of the mouth will do well to place laterally between the jaws from back to front a small piece of wood not thicker than a pencil. Are there defects of a similar kind? Yes. Pushing the lips out like a funnel, protruding the jaws, separating the lips for the sake of showing fine teeth, and knitting the brows. What is the remedy? The chin might be held back by a band of paper round the neck and pinned through the ends in front of the chin. This band, which ought not to be wider than the finger, acts, of course, as a reminder. Anyone inflicted with these or kindred habits should sing before a mirror. Question. Have you anything to add to what has already been said about breathing? Answer. It may be added that when the lungs are completely filled with air, the natural tendency is to be quickly rid of the superabundance. Consequently, the sounds at the start are strong and often unsteady. Then they become weaker with the lessening of the breath. The majority of musical phrases demand the opposite method. On this account, the pupil should begin with a small amount of pressure, increasing it gradually as the supply of air diminishes. The even flow of a long phrase, a long passage of agility, the stability of a long tone, all require a continuous and well-managed pressure of the diaphragm. Question. Is not the size and sonority of the locale to be considered? Answer. Certainly. The necessity for a steady pressure is especially felt in large halls and in places bad for sound. Air given out in jerks does not travel. A moderate and prolonged pressure, on the contrary, gradually puts in motion the whole mass of circumambient air. The faintest sound given in this manner, if not drowned by the accompaniment, will reach the ears of the most distant auditor. Chi sa respirare, sa cantare, Maria Celloni. Okay. I should be more respectful when I read about Maria. I don't know who Maria Celloni is. That's someone we should look up. If anyone wants to look someone up, Maria Celloni. Let's see. There's nobody chatting. So, okay. All right, so let's review. Section 9. Just 1 second. I dropped my pencil. So, you can see where I picked up some of my biases, I guess. When I first read Garcia, this line really stood out to me. That he was saying, to prepare for emitting the voice, you have to give attention to the position of the body. And that is still something that I still really think is true. And a lot of the rest of this, though, I think is pretty conditional on what it is that you're singing, perhaps. Maybe a lot more useful for a soprano, perhaps. Or a certain type of soprano, perhaps. Than universally true. So shall we continue? How would you describe the position of the body? Answer. The body must be straight, well planted on the feet, and without any other support. The shoulders well back, the head erect, the expression of the face calm. This is from before Mario Del Monaco, I guess, and all of these really wild singing and acting awesome opera singers. And I'm assuming before Dupre and all these guys that Garcia, I'm told, is associated with, who were known for big sounds. But that was a tenor. And maybe doing something really different from Jenny Lind, his other famous student. Or it could be that the whole Jenny Lind thing is just a lot of name dropping, you know, for a few lessons. Or who knows? I'm not sure. If anybody has answers to that, that would be good to know. Because some of what he says coming up here just makes no sense. And then a lot of it's great. So the shoulders well back, I think is true sometimes. I think you can also do things with the shoulders forward. The head erect. That's good just for being available to the audience. The expression of the face calm. Yeah. Should the mouth be opened as a means of obtaining power and beauty of sound? And he says that is that this is a common error. The thing is, if you have this kind of like shape. Oh, let me start over. I'm going to go over on the left here, in the margin. So let's say we have like this kind of shape, sort of a funnel shape. And you're trying to take energy from point A, you know, pass it through point B, and you're trying to have it leave and radiate out by point C. Well, at point C. And let's say that the source of your sound is something really heavy and dense and massive compared to the stuff that's inside of this funnel through which you want to transmit the energy. So for the voice, the stuff that's inside of the funnel is air, and it's really easy to move. It has very low impedance. It doesn't impede you if you try to walk through the room. Even though the air is resisting you, you don't notice, because your body has really high impedance and the air has really low impedance. So because of the impedance mismatch, there's not much interaction that you notice. It doesn't stop you from going forward. It doesn't transfer a lot of energy, right? But actually, energy is being transferred. And if you were to just increase how much energy is, like how fast the air is moving, for instance, until it's 100 or 200 kilometers an hour, now it can knock you over. But let's say you're holding like a really, really big kite. Well, so that kite is going to help match the impedance of the wind to you. And if the kite's really big and the wind is only like 30 kilometers per hour, and the kite's big enough, you can fly with that kite for short distances or whatever. And the wind doesn't need to be that much. So that's what's called impedance matching. And if your vocal folds are at point A, compared to the air, they're your body. They're like mucosa. They're really high impedance, right? And then what, this area between A and B, if it's narrow, and it gets narrower like this, and then before it opens up again, it helps match the impedance between the vocal folds and the air that's in here. And if you want something from real life that works in a similar way, it's the earbuds. Earbud headphones sometimes go all the way into the ear, and they have this narrowed area, or the in-ear monitors. And those are really loud when you put them right up against your ear, because you've got an impedance match there. But if you were to take that same shape and use it to try to listen to your earbuds by putting them far away from your ear, it's really crappy for going into the room. So for going into the vocal track, this kind of earbuds funnel shape is great. Okay, now what we wind up with is air inside the vocal tract that has slightly higher impedance than the air that's outside of the vocal tract. So B is higher than C. Now you've got the opposite thing that you want to do. Now you want to match the energy that's in here to this lower impedance air outside. So what you need is this shape that gets bigger. When this part around C gets bigger, then you get a better match between the air that's in here in B and the air that's out there on the other side of C. You get a better transfer of energy and you're louder. You're going to be louder. And that's why all the really powerful singers have their mouth so open. It's just physics. You can't beat physics. You can have all the old school books that you want, and not all of them say that. So I guess if you have all the old school books, then you're not stuck with just Garcia's advice here. But you can see a lot of that you need to open the mouth a lot. And then also, it's not going to be separating the jaws by the thickness of a finger. That's also going to constrict that area number 5 that we were looking at, that he was mentioning up here in figure 14. That's going to get smaller the smaller you make your mouth. So that's going to lose the darkness that he's talking about. And if you then make area of interest number 4 bigger, that's going to make it even brighter, not darker. But he's trying to figure these from his little mirrors, you know, and working with the what he knows from his time. So the tongue, limp and motionless, neither raised at the point nor swollen at the root. But as far as I know, it takes muscle to not make the tongue swollen at the root. To kind of compress the tongue, you have to work. If you're not working, it's going to be swollen at the root. So that's also interesting. I would say that's incorrect stuff that Garcia's talking about. I don't know that there's going to be much natural falling of the jaw. As far as I know, your jaw's not that heavy. and it's just not, you're not opening your jaw by relaxing. You're opening your jaw by using a combination, actually, of the jaws of muscles that are there just on purpose to help you open your jaw. And then in order to control like how much you use the muscles that are closed, that would close your jaw. And then when you close your jaw, it's the opposite. Unless you're doing it as hard and as fast as possible, you're using your jaw opening muscles to counterbalance that. It doesn't feel like anything because like all of your movements work that way. Almost. So, I'll say that the exaggerated opening favors neither low nor high notes. Probably it's easier to work on your range if that's what you're trying to do with your mouth more closed. It like tames the sound. When you lower all the resonances of the vocal tract, which is what you do when you close your mouth, which makes things darker, by the way. But anyway, which is weird that he doesn't notice that if you when you open your mouth, if my mouth is really closed, compared to, well, I'm twanging now, so I'm ruining it. But so if my mouth is really closed, compared to, oh, and my mouth is really open, even if I keep my throat open and make the sound dopey and breathy like that, it gets brighter just from opening my mouth. So it's weird that he didn't notice that opening your mouth makes things brighter. I guess, you know, when you've got tools like mirrors and stuff and you're looking inside, you want all the answers to be something that has to do with your new toys, I guess. Any questions? No. Okay, and the chat's up if you guys got questions about what Garcia is saying here. You're welcome to ask. Make sure that streams are healthy. So I'll be right back. Ooh. so we're back. Reading Garcia. See? So, and we're on this section from Hints on Singing. We're in the section on preparation for emitting the voice. And if you stay tuned, I'll be reading section 10 in a minute. Or I guess we'll stop there at section, at the end of section 9. So, he's recommending to place laterally between the jaws, from back to front, a small piece of wood not thicker than a pencil. If someone can figure out exactly what he means, I first read this like 15 years ago, and I still don't know what he means. I don't know what that is. For increasing, if it's difficult to increase, to diminish or increase the opening of the mouth. Why would that be difficult? I don't understand. Maybe I'm just completely misunderstanding what he means by any of this. But anyway. So other defects of a similar kind. Yes, pushing the lips out like a funnel. Now, if you think about what that does, pushing the lips out like a funnel makes it moves area of interest number two. And because you moved area of interest number two away from area of interest number three, so unless you raised your larynx, if you didn't raise your larynx by the same amount, your vocal tract gets longer. So all resonances go down. And also, if you made the opening smaller at the same time, that also makes all the resonances go down. If you think of covering, which is basically the vowel modification that he recommends, that also is tuning the whole timbre down as you go up by rounding the lips. Separating the lips for the sake of showing fine teeth is something he doesn't like. And knitting the brows. So I don't know. Pavarotti kind of famous for knitting his brows in crazy ways. And who's the guy who looks like Mr. Bean? A pretty good tenor. Anyway, he was really popular in my day. But he knitted his brows a lot and sounded fine. And when it comes to showing the teeth, like Delmonico or Corelli or something often did, sometimes not, sometimes it was kind of old man mouth, but sometimes you get the teeth. And then with Pavarotti, sometimes just the bottom teeth, kind of sound. Doing this can really help. And it's not about showing off fine teeth. It's about shortening the vocal tract without raising the larynx. So I think he could have noticed that. Anyway. So he recommends holding the chin back by a band of paper around the neck and pinned through the ends in front of the chin. So a piece of paper around your neck. The band and so if you picture like a collar that goes around your neck, and what he's talking, so that makes me think what he's talking about is not moving the jaw forward, because your jaw can move. Like, it can move forward and back and side to side and up and down. It moves in three dimensions. But I think what he's talking about is actually neck protraction. So he's talking about anchoring the neck. And you would have a piece of paper going around your neck to make sure that you don't. So by putting the jaw forward, this is what he means, I think. And that's why, yeah. And, you know, if you're walking around your everyday life, and you want your voice to be stronger, when you're just talking to people. This trick right here that he's talking about, with maybe not with a piece of paper, because you'll look ridiculous, but if you're trying to speak with confidence in your everyday life, and you'll notice me breaking the rule, this rule, all the time as I talk to you here. Because as I talk to you here, I often get tempted to go towards the microphone with my head. And even though, so I'm getting closer, now we have the proximity effect, probably maybe my voice even got louder. But if I keep my chin back, basically, by making sure that my neck is here, if I move my microphone, you can get maybe a more honest idea of how it changes the sound compared to when my neck is more forward. So I think Garcia here is talking about neck protraction, although he's putting it as pushing the jaw forward. But I think it's not pushing the jaw forward, but when I anchor my neck, and if you imagine a band of paper going around my chin that's pinned in the back, I wouldn't be breaking that band of paper. And then when I start to protract, I break it. So that's maybe something people ought to check out. Garcia's recommendation for neck anchoring. And then he mentions the big, most important thing. So I guess we'll use the highlighter here. Anyone inflicted with these or kindred habits should sing before a mirror. And in general, I think singing in front of the mirror is probably the most powerful tool you could have. I guess I'll use the red pen from now on, because it's better. So, now we get to his advice on breathing, and then also I feel this is kind of sketchy, because he's already made some observations that I think contradict this already in this book. I don't know if it was written in maybe not written in chronological order, just assembled like this, because he told us before that the clear and ringing sound, when you sing into a candle, it doesn't move the flame. So logically, we can work out that what's going on is there's not a lot of air coming out. And now he's telling us that if your lungs are really full, then you're gonna wind up starting out too loud. The sounds at the start are strong and often unsteady. And before, he was telling us that a clear and ringing sound doesn't stir a flame. Now, these strong and unsteady beginnings are the body getting rid of a superabundance of air. But how is the air getting out if you have a clear and ringing sound that's not moving a candle? Where's the air going, Garcia? Where is it going? And my answer, and the reason why I think he's wrong, is that the air is staying in your lungs. And if you're strong enough, and you also have the resonance in place that's needed to control the air. Resonance plus muscle plus ligament, I guess. Well, that air is not going anywhere. It's staying in your lungs, and it's actually helping you hold yourself up. It's doing other things now. And if you get a strong feedback loop going between the resonance of the vocal tract and the source, that's what's controlling the air. And that makes you stronger. And also the air is not going to be leaking out too fast. It doesn't have a way to get out. And that's what I find in my own singing. Is when I'm having a good day, I'm breathing in like a huge breath. And however, I'm not feeling like I have to quickly get rid of it. I'm like strong enough to hang on to that breath. I'm fit enough to have that big of a breath. And when I start, there's no need to get rid of any of it. And when I finish, hopefully I only used about 10%. So now what I need to do is just top off the breath by this small amount. And I never had to do this part where as the phrase goes on, I have to start pushing harder and harder, or as he calls it, raising the pressure. Right? And we can also deconstruct what he's saying and come up with that it's wrong by noticing that he's saying you're going to begin with a small amount of pressure and increase it gradually as the supply of air diminishes. But your pitch that you're singing is a combination of the stretch of your vocal folds, like how long they are, and the resistance and the air pressure that is causing them to vibrate at a particular frequency. So if you start messing with the pressure and you want to keep the same pitch, something's got to happen to your vocal folds. And if you're it doesn't make much sense that what he's talking about, that there would be more pressure or less pressure at the beginning than at the end. Maybe effort if you're running out of air. But if you had this good, clear, and ringing sound, I don't think you're going to be really running out of air. People are wondering when you're going to breathe. Because it controls the air by itself. Well, not by itself, but almost by itself. So, one thing that could be why he's saying this is because he's working with sopranos, mostly. And as far as I know, whereas a tenor is taking advantage of reduced airflow from the sound being metallic, plus often a formant harmonic coupling, tenors can sing these crazy long phrases if they're singing that way, with fuller density and metal, and starting out with a big breath. And even the soprano with the highest contact quotient, I think, is going to wind up using more air than the tenor in a lot of cases. So maybe what he's talking about is really good advice for sopranos, but for someone trying to imitate like Corelli or something, that's really bad advice, I think. Instead, and I'd have to ask certain sopranos what they think, especially ones who are making like bigger sounds and more athletic, maybe. What do you think of this? Because I get a feeling that they also take rather large breaths, and that they try to work with the lungs full and keep them full and get caught out as seldom as possible. You don't want to be caught like in a habit of constantly trying to hold yourself up and act in front of an audience and sing when you have a low oxygen, low air in the lungs. also low oxygen, but anyway. And then finally we have this section on the sound radiating into the room. And again, I don't know where he's getting these acoustics, but it's not how it works. So the necessity for a steady pressure and especially felt in large halls. That's true. Well, no, I don't think so. You need steady pressure to have steady pitch and vibrato and all that stuff. So you always need steady pressure, and you pretty much always have steady pressure. Like, I don't think it's really a thing for most classical singers that they're having problems keeping the pressure steady, not if the pitch is steady. Air giving out in jerks does not travel. It's not air that we're giving out. Well, I mean, it barely is, but it's vibrations, and they travel just the same. A moderate and prolonged pressure, on the contrary, gradually puts in motion the whole mass of circumambient air, and that's not how that works. That's why thunder is not really quiet. That you don't have to warm up the air to get it vibrating. You can just make one sudden vibration and we're all going to hear it. The faintest sound drowned by the accompaniment. Yeah, okay. So he's saying, I mean, that's true that quiet sounds, if there's not a strong accompaniment, everyone can hear. But so that's section. We did section 9 today. And then I'll put a note here that we're finishing at section 10. Episode 5 starts there. Episode 4 was there. Bring us back to Garcia here. Okay. So that was the fifth installment of Hints on Singing by Manuel Garcia. By the time we finish, I'm going to do the whole book. And then I'm going to do a different book. Let's see what's up in the chat. If there's any questions here. Yeah, I got some questions, so we're going to see. Chats. Okay. So I can read this. It's not really effective. 1 second, guys. I'm going to read your chats. Questions. Better be nice things in there. So, okay. It's from Mr. Opera. From the are we the Capulets or the Montagues? I don't know. Let's see. So resonance is a built-in stop to wasting air. Well, yes and no. Yes and no. And hi, Olivier. Well, I'll start with your last question. So sopranos don't benefit from metal as much as tenors. Sopranos, unless they're singing really low right now, unless the note is low, like what they have these discussions about chest and whether you should use chest or whether you should not use chest. Maybe I'll do the This Is Opera video on that. Si devo mai usare la voce di petto. That's how, I forget what his name is. I'm really bad at remembering names, but there's this really weird opera guy who's asking this old soprano, I think, if you should ever use the chest voice. And then she answers him like, no, like totally no, like metallic. Like, her answer is completely metallic and complete, so completely chest. But she's saying don't use it. So it was really funny. But he's asking her in a falsetto. So, and remember, Garcia was saying that this middle soprano range is falsetto. He changed his mind about the term, but same thing. That falsetto cannot be metallic. So 95% of the soprano's range basically cannot be metallic. And then Garcia's talking about, like, what happens if you try to push the metal too high, I think. When he's talking about chest and not bringing the chest too high, trying to flip early into falsetto. That's what a soprano's got to do. Because she's going to run into a problem because she can't take metal into the soprano range. So I think that's what that was in. I think that was episode 3 that we talked about that. Stefan Zucker, that's the guy. Yeah, so he asked his question about, basically, if you want to translate that question, he asks her, should you ever use metal in the voice? And he asks her without metal in the voice. And then she answers, no, you should never use metal. But her answer uses metal. And so it's funny. And her voice is so much more dominant because she's using metal in the voice. So it's not that women can't use metal. And sopranos, even, for really low notes, can use it and then sometimes don't. And when they don't, it's way softer than when they do use it. Yeah. And then mezzos sometimes don't use it. Sometimes a mezzo just stays neutral the whole time. And then she's not as loud. It's not as big. And then if you have like a honking big Dalila, if she has the ability to switch to a metallic sound, then it's going to be freaking awesome when she goes into the chest range. And you're going to understand her text better. Yeah, I think it's like easier to understand as well as louder. So, but no, sopranos don't benefit from metal as much as tenors. They barely benefit at all. It doesn't really apply to them unless they're singing these really low chest notes. But they do use resonance to stop the wasting of air, to slow down the air. They don't just use resonance to do that. You also have to have a good source in the first place before you start using resonance to boost it or to interfere with it in a constructive way. But so you need that source, and the source itself, like your thyroarytenoid muscles and everything, and your lateral cricoarytenoids and your intraarytenoids, and I think even control of the top of the arytenoid cartilages, so I need my anatomy in front of me. Oh my god. Thyroepiglottic. Anyway. I don't have my anatomy in front of me. But these muscles running along the mucosa that connect the top of the arytenoids to the epiglottis, basically. I think they might also play some role. But especially they're going to play a role in making this twang, this narrowing in area of interest number 2. And that's going to also control airflow. So, yeah. I guess a lot of things are helping to control airflow. So you take a full breath and let... hi, Dove, by the way, and thanks for the Stefan Zucker name check. I'm really bad at names, as you guys are going to find out. If I don't have a list in front of me, I can't do it. I can remember all kinds of weird fact facts and useless things, but not names. So you take a full breath and let the recoil create pressure against your vocal folds resistance. I don't think the recoil has too much of an effect. There is this elastic recoil, and I guess for the very beginning, it's playing some role for the very beginning of the onset. But I don't think so. I think like you increase intra-abdominal pressure, and sometimes I'm either like flexing. I'm putting some slight extension in the middle back, or flexion, depending with scapular retraction, and basically doing different things with my ribs and spine, and maybe some gravity, and combining a whole bunch of things plus some muscle to start the pitch, to start the sound. But I don't think the recoil is all that significant. It's kind of cool, the idea that you would have this stored up energy, and if you do things just right, you could just wait for the bounce, you know. And I used to really try to chase that, but I don't anymore. I kind of think more like I come up with an idea of what I want the posture to be, and then I try to think of what that would feel like from the point of view of the person doing it. So it might be like throwing a punch, or it might be like throwing a ball, or it might be like lifting something, or whatever. But some kind of basically movement with your whole body that incorporates what it is that you're trying to do. So as far as creating the resistance and holding the pressure, I think the key thing is you distribute that as much as possible, all of that effort, to the whole thoracic cavity, to the whole rib cage, the abs, the pelvic floor, diaphragm. Nothing doing more than its share. So, and especially not any one part of the trunk getting stuck and compressed while the other parts are inflating. So if I look in the mirror, Garcia's technique, really great. I look in the mirror and I see, I'm going to move the microphone away a little bit. But I take a breath and I see this. I know I'm screwed. because this has really expanded, but that means something else really got compressed. And oh yeah, my lower back just got the crap compressed out of it. So now I've lost all this whole ability to like breathe into my back. It's all squished. So then what I would want to do is like, well, what's going on? Okay, my ribs are pretty much coming unglued from the chair. So I take a breath. Oh yeah, that doesn't want to stay. And then I figure out what I got to do to make it stay. What would it feel like? Oh, now that expands my lower back. Okay. Okay. And then from there, I just make the intention of singing, starting the sound. That's it. Nothing really special, other than you happen to be in the right position so I think, yeah, if that's all for today, if there's any questions from This Is Opera, no, I think they're maybe mad at me for taking over for another day. But I think we're gonna troll them with these live streams for quite a while. And so tomorrow I'll be back with more watching This Is Opera and talking about all that stuff. So see you guys for now. This has been Mr. Opera Reads Manuel Garcia, and you're on Mr. Opera, or you might be on This Is Opera. And thanks for watching, and for those of you who had questions and comments, thanks for your questions and comments. So, see you guys.
Scrivo, e come vivo, vivo. Il povero sa mia dieta, sciano da gran signore, rimedi inni d'amore, per sogni e per chimere, e per castelli in aria. L'animo due ladri gli occhi belli.